Now, on to the next step in our look round the anatomy of the car. And this week, we are dealing with brakes. And without more ado, let's go straight to Banbury, to one of the leading brake manufacturers, Automotive Products, where we join Richard Hudson Evans.
Like so many things on one's car, one tends to take for granted that one has, and always hopefully has, brakes. In the early days, it was all done mechanically by rods and cables. Now, these days, it happens hydraulically. But I suppose for the majority, the nearest they actually get to their brakes is the brake pedal inside the car or the topping up reservoir under the bonnet. But to seek some guidance as to what actually happens in the great link-up, let's now speak to Percy Holman, in charge of service training here at Banbury. Now, how is the conversion from the mechanical side of it, when you press the brake pedal here, to the hydraulic side with the fluid coming out of the other end? How does this actually happen?
Well, that movement of the brake pedal, Richard, is passed to a push rod in the master cylinder for the purpose of pushing the piston forward in the cylinder to convey fluid through these steel pipes and these rubber hoses down to the brake assemblies themselves at the four corners of the motor car.
Now, a lot of cars have servo assistance, a servo such as this. Now, how does this fit into this system?
Yes, that's so. This is not an untypical arrangement with the servo between the brake pedal and the master cylinder itself.
It gets its energy from where?
This gets its energy from the induction manifold of the engine directly through this rubber hose.
And it all happens by vacuum?
And this happens by vacuum, yes.
The one main thing we're always told with our brakes is to regularly top up. Why is this?
There is a more important need that the motorist occasionally looks at the level of the fluid in the master cylinder and top up when necessary. And quite obviously, if there's a serious fall in the fluid level, then he's got to do something about it, seek professional advice, because there's probably a leakage.
What about changing fluid? We're told so often now that one must change one's brake fluid rather like engine oil.
Yes, well, we reckon a hydraulic brake system should always have clean fluid in it. And there is some process of deterioration. We think it should be changed at 18 months, 24,000 miles, whichever comes sooner.
Bewildering choice of fluids on the market now for the motorist.
That's so. He has a wide choice of brake fluids, but from our point of view, the vehicle manufacturer requires the right fluid to be used in the system, and that he recommends.
The motorist gets that from the handbook?
He can get this from the vehicle manufacturer's handbook.
Well, let's now just follow the line down to the front end and have a look at the disc brake. Well, nowadays, a lot of people have brakes such as these, but I suspect there are quite a number who don't really understand how they work.
Well, the disc brake, of course, is in two parts. The disc, which is a part of the wheel assembly and, of course, rotates with it. This caliper unit, a hydraulic unit which straddles the disc. Fluid from the master cylinder, as the brake pedal is applied, comes to the back of two pistons inside the caliper to move these pads onto the disc to stop it rotating.
The disc brake pads. Any adjustment necessary?
No adjustment is necessary at all. The automatic adjustments carried out by the caliper.
So just the pads to worry about?
Just the pads.
What are the tips there?
Well, I think the important one is that pads should be changed in axle sets. We put them in a box, in fact, complete with the necessary split pins and anti-rattle clips.
How long should you allow the pads to wear down before changing them?
Well, they shouldn't be allowed to wear down beyond an eighth of an inch from the steel backing.
The absolute minimum,
isn't it? That's the absolute minimum.
And what happens if you don't do that?
Well, we've got an example of that here, where, of course, the material has gone down to the steel plate and with resultant damage to the disc.
And nasty noises. What's the average mileage, do you reckon, for a set of pads?
It's very difficult to qualify this. Naturally, we don't all drive the same. I would say some 15 or 20,000 miles.
So much for the disc brake. Now let's go on to the drum brake. Of course, often those with discs at the front would have drums at the rear. And then, of course, there are still many cars with drums all round. Percy, what's within?
Well, the drum brake, like the disc brake, is in two parts. The brake drum, which is normally secured by two set screws.
And the rest of it?
And the rest of it, two brake shoes, which are pushed into the brake drum by a hydraulic wheel cylinder at the bottom here. Fluid from the master cylinder comes between two pistons, moves the shoes to the...
Forces the linings onto the inside of the drum. Are they adjustable?
There are some self-adjusting brakes, but this one happens to be adjustable, and this is the adjuster just here.
Now, on to the thing that motorists need to worry about, and that, of course, are the brake linings. How far should one run brake linings before doing something about it?
Well, this is an example of a new brake shoe with the linings well down. This is one which has been worn to the right condition, just to the top of the rivet heads. And this is a dangerously worn one going down to the rivet heads.
So the tip is to wear it just down until the rivet heads are about to appear.
Just to the rivet heads about to appear.
The thing that puzzles me, the disc brake is a more modern brake. Why isn't it used on all cars? We still see so many produced with drum brakes.
Well, the disc brake, of course, is a technical advance, and it's put on the front of the motor car where most of the braking is needed. And it's happy in combination with the drum brake at the rear with a good handbrake mechanism.
Percy Holman, thank you very much. Well, now let's just go on and recap some of the points that have been made. If you have disc brakes, don't let your brake pads get worn down below an eighth of an inch absolute minimum. If you have drum brakes, then always ensure that you have sufficient brake lining material left to stand clearly proud of the shoe's rivet heads. Don't run your brakes until they reach the metal-to-metal stage. For your sake and everybody else's, change your pads and linings before they become worn out. It could be cheaper. It goes without saying, of course, keep the fluid reservoir fully topped up, stick to the recommended specification of hydraulic fluid for your car, and never reuse old brake fluid for topping up. Finally, if your brake fluid loss, or indeed the amount of free play down at the pedal, becomes excessive, don't delay and don't meddle if you're not an experienced mechanic. Go to a garage immediately.